squares pool. Ritt. That's right. Garrett Ryan Ritt. Because, of course, the man that picked the numbers and the names ends up walking away with $1,130 out of the $2,000 prize pool. How convenient is that? What a coinkydink. Not at all shady. Not at all greasy. I mean, who would think twice about the host of the pool winning the pool? Just jump out the pool on that, old man. Not only did Ritt pull that crap, he got in your face about that crap. He then fired off a look-at-me email to the group, which included Hawk and Alvy. Here's what Ritt wrote to the 28 other people that he played in that pool. Quote, "Not much more I can say other than, yeah, baby. It's the miracle of all miracles. I won my own pool for the first time in my life. I'm going to live it up." In the immortal words of Conor McGregor, "I'd like to apologize to absolutely nobody."
I'd like to take this chance to apologize to absolutely nobody. The double champ does what the f*** he wants.
The double Ritt does what the bleep he wants. We are joined right now by the flight deck, James Kelly, on his fresh Comrex line. It's not a big head bets day, but he cashed a big bleeping ticket. Head, what's going on?
What's up, Jim Rome?
What's up, big head?
Not much, man. Feeling pretty damn good today.
Yeah, I bet you are, head. Listen, before we get into that, you actually sent along a picture from the South Point Casino. I'm looking at it right now. It's incredible. For those, well, I was going to say, for those who can't see it, you and I are the only ones who can see it. What is the picture of?
So it's us, you talking about our bet from last segment. They got your show streamed all over the entire casino there at the sports book and the bar and everywhere in the casino. It's a great sports book there. And my guy happens to be there, going to cash my ticket in as we speak, actually.
Oh, I love that. All right, so not only that, how ironic, head, that your guy is there cashing your big fat ticket, and he gets a picture of me talking about you, and CBS Sports Network has got your big head on the lower third, and it's graphiced perfectly. I mean, what are the chances that your guy was in that casino to get that shot? Did you set that up?
No, I didn't. Same time every year. He's got my futures. He's already sent me the basketball, the football, all kinds of stuff. I'm already looking at him for next year. So he's there all the time. So I'm like, bam, perfect.
Hey, listen, this is not a paid promotional announcement, but big shout out to South Point. It looks great. They've got us up on the big screen. I love that. Appreciate that, folks. Nice job. Nice job. All right, so back to the other point. How does it feel to hit a big ticket like that?
Well, I told my wife last night it'll never happen again because it's 60-1, and that's I'm almost.
First of all,
like
why'd you tell your wife?
She's already spending the money, so it's all good with that. But I'm still pissed about losing the Kansas City -3 bet.
Sure, you're not.
Yeah, I mean it's not as bad now.
I know you, big head. You probably bet $50 on that. What do you care?
Yeah, well, you said last week, you're like, dude, I'm shocked you're going against Tampa, and I should have went with my initial instincts on that one.
All right, so you're not at all upset that you cost listeners money. It's just your own ego and your own betting percentage.
Yeah.
And you
gamble what you have.
You knew better, man. You played Tampa Bay all year long, and that is so unlike you. I said it, man. This is not what you do. You always take value. You always go against the grain.
Especially that defensive line, too. And then I thought Patrick Mahomes and Andy Reid could overcome it. And about two series in, I knew I was completely wrong.
No, I was going to say that. About two series in, you and I were going back and forth like, dude, they're so much better. They literally are so much better than KC. All right, so little did I know, because I don't really follow. I mean, I follow you guys. I just don't really care what you do. I mean, I care what you do, but I don't pay attention to what you do. And now I know that I should. The hell was going on behind my back? What, this whole thing with Hawk. So tell me how Hawk rolled up on you and approached you to cut him in. What was that like?
He hit me on G-Chat and wanted to get in on a gamble, of course, one day before the freaking Super Bowl, 2 days before the Super Bowl. So, I mean, you knew deep down, Jim, there was no shot in hell I was going to let that damn idiot in. But I let him think it all week long. He kept texting me on Saturday, Sunday. I'm like, I don't know. I might do it, man. It sounds really, really good. And then, of course, there was no way I was going to do it, so I didn't.
That's really funny. So you were like stringing this guy along, but you know what, Hawk? I mean, I don't like you very much. I don't respect you very much, but this is pretty enticing. So what do you have to offer? Was there a negotiation, or did Hawk just come like, this is how it is? I'll buy in for $100. You pay me $400, and that's the way it is? Or did you negotiate him to that point and then rip the rug?
No, matter of fact, talking down to me like, how, hey, this is how this whole thing is going to work. So that's why I just egged him on the entire weekend. I'm like, okay, Hawk, that does sound pretty fair, man. You pay $100 and we win $400. Oh, okay.
He told you how it was going to go.
Yeah, exactly.
The best part about that was you leading him to believe that that's how that was going to go. And Hawk's like, oh, yeah, $400. It's going to be cool. Me and the lady can have a nice little dinner, buy me some IPAs, maybe some pot gummies. This is going to be cool, man. Like,
I'm
you'd
not
already
even
spent
kidding,
that money,
Jim,
right?
He probably texted me 16 times separately on this whole thing because he really thought I was going to do it, too. He kind of ghosted me on Sunday after that, though.
I was going to say, so how good did it feel when you did do him the way you did, and what was his reaction? He ghosted you?
Yeah, he ghosted me after that part, because after I sent the tweet, I saw him react to it online, but then I texted him a couple times, and I still haven't heard from him until this morning, but he's not really talking to me much.
So that felt pretty good, though, right?
Oh, fantastic.
I knew it would.
It'll be even better when I spend that money on Nation Golf's biggest competitor apparel.
That is the best. I was going to say, it's funny you brought that up. I was going to say, how much of that money do you get to keep? How much of that money goes to the wife? And of what you get to keep, do you reinvest for 2021, 22 futures? Or are you going to spend money on his competitive apparel?
There will be some against his company for sure. I'm putting $1,000 more back down for futures for next year, and then the wife needs some new furniture. So
I got to ask you, you back away from Hawk, dude. He's had enough. All right, so what are you looking at for next year? Now that your guy is at the sports book to get your money, I know you were telling him to get down. What are you telling him to hit for next year?
Well, I'm going to hit Kansas City no matter what to hedge on 5-1, because that's pretty good odds, and I think they'll be back there next year, fix that line, they'll be fine. I hit the Nets and the Lakers for basketball, but I hit the Nets right before they got Harden, so I got two of them out for that one.
What did you get for that?
Plus 575, I think, for Brooklyn, which is nice. So
That's nice. All right.
And the Lakers are my hedge, so I could win off that. I think that's like 275 or 300, so I should win off that bet. I'm looking at Major League Baseball right now. Man, the Dodgers would be tough to beat there, but I will find something.
Didn't you hit them before they got Trevor Bauer?
I did not yet. I have not hit those yet. I'm still thinking about the Yankees,
but you get
too.
Them before those things go down. That's your whole play.
I know, and
sleep
they beat
the switch.
Me to it. Yeah.
Did you, really quickly, did you hit the Bucks? The Bucks last night were 11-1 for next year. Have you hit that? Where are they right now?
They're still at 11-1 is what I got right now. I haven't hit them yet. I'm going to use Kansas City. I'll find a couple different ones out there. The 60-1 won't play anymore because there's nothing good there. But there's a couple good values, like the Titans at 29-1. Pittsburgh's like at 27-1 or something like that. I haven't hit either one of those.
I like both those.
Yeah,
dude,
right?
Why do you remember, though, didn't we not hit Chicago at 35-1? And why did we do that?
Well, because they kind of had the same philosophy as the Bucks here. Like, I mean, they have a pretty good team except for the quarterback and then obviously the coach.
Yeah, because that's not important.
Yeah, the coach is not important either, and that didn't turn out very good. But I think you did hit the Bucks at 12-1, maybe?
Hey, keep that to yourself, man. No, I didn't.
I did. I mean, yeah. 60-12-1.
Dude, who do you hate more, Hawk or Ritt?
Hawk, by far.
Why?
Speaking of Ritt, that snake salesman, oil hour, whatever it's called, finally. He hit me probably 8 times to buy his last squares, Jim.
Did
like
you?
Freaking? No, I didn't. Hell no. I knew what he was doing. He G-chatted me. He texted me. He called me. He emailed me. I'm like, dude, leave me alone, Ritt. I'm not buying your squares, man.
Let's quickly go to Buffalo. Jake in Buffalo. It's good to have you, Jake. How are you?
What's going on, Jimmy? Congratulations to the Super Bowl champion Tampa Bay Buccaneers. But I want to talk about this year's real winner, the restaurant industry of Tampa, Florida. Because based on my extensive research, Jim, this was the fattest coaching matchup in Super Bowl history. Reports indicate that Bruce Arians was disappointed that the post-game confetti wasn't made out of Fruit Loops and bacon bits. And I'm just glad old Bruce didn't try to peel the silver plating off the Lombardi trophy to reveal a creamy chocolate center. And Jim, every restaurant in town was trying to cash in on the hype. The local Tampa Chipotle had a special going called the Super Burrito Bowl, which is actually just a trough of burrito fillings designed to feed a family of four or one morbidly obese professional football coach. The use of your hands is optional, so you can authentically Hoover this meal face first, like Candy Reed and Bruschetta Arians. But we love to see champions compete, and the matchup between these two heavyweights of the coaching world was one for the ages. And that doesn't even count the post-game celebration at the Old Country Buffet. Anyway, Jim, I'm getting out. Peace.
Anyway, Jim. All right, then. Let's go to Philadelphia. Zach in Philly. Good to have you, Zach. How are you?
Vance Mack, it's an honor to be speaking to you today, the day after the Super Bowl. I got to give it up to the GOAT, Mr. Thomas Brady. Jim, this is a guy that won his first Super Bowl when I was 14 years old. I made a bet with my friends. I won double lunch in the cafeteria from this guy. And now I've got my own kid running around like crazy watching him win Super Bowls at 43. But, Jim, more importantly, I got to focus on this guy. Yes, you said I was from Philadelphia. I've seen Andy Reid run this before. Hey, Andy. Yeah, you may have won the Super Bowl last year with the most talented roster in the league. You may have thrown people off the scent. And what a pungent scent that is, Jim. But, Andy, we haven't forgotten. We haven't forgotten the way that you blow these games at the end of the half. We haven't forgotten the way you use your timeouts. We haven't forgotten the fact that for some reason you think it's a good idea to call timeouts for the other quarterbacks as they go down the field and score. And, Andy, more importantly, buddy, I haven't forgotten the time at the North Hills Country Club Mother's Day brunch 2004 when you showed up and you closed down the buffet. You didn't leave any shrimp cocktail, any lox and capers for me and my friend and my friend's mom. And, Andy, let me tell you something. You're a one-hit wonder. One-hit wonder!
Wow, Zach. Let's go to Jeff T. in New York City. What's up, Jeff T.?
My man, Jim Rome, let me tell you. I took the CDC's advice, and instead of having a Super Bowl party, we went virtual this year and partied on a Zoom conference call with friends and coworkers. Let's hope virtual touchdown shots don't become a thing. Also, that halftime show will go down as one of the worst in history. As you mentioned, Jim Rome, the guy at everyone's party who usually goes with, oh, the day after the Super Bowl should be a national holiday, yeah, well, he switched it up this year, Jim Rome, and was saying, this is the one year I can't wait for the weekend to end. Beyonce grinding on a chair was more entertaining. I need a halftime show that makes me want to pretend to turn the Zoom camera off and punch the clown.
What? That's not a good call. No. You don't like that call.
I don't like that call. Not a very good call.
All right, so I think I'll go ahead, Hawk.
Good night now!
Whether you're here to have fun or here to win, we've got you. And we've got your safety in mind, too. So if you need a break, and these days, who doesn't? Come add a new chapter to your memories. Grand Casino, let your story begin.